Hey guys, Dr. Berg here. In this video, we're going to talk about the relationship between saturated fats, eating saturated fats, and diabetes or pre-diabetes. I really wanted to create a video on this one point because there's so much confusion and conflicting data out there, okay? And in this video, I brought in a special guest. This guy is almost an equivalent as far as knowledge in the area of health. He's a really good-looking guy as well. So let's bring him on. So this guy is going to help just explain insulin and the pre-diabetic state called insulin resistance.
Hey guys, how are you?
So let me explain what insulin is, okay? Insulin is a hormone that regulates blood sugars. It lowers blood sugars. In the presence of insulin, you're not going to burn fat, and it causes fat to be stored. But insulin resistance is something a little different because it basically, as insulin connects into the cell doesn't absorb it anymore. It blocks it. So on the other side of the cell, you have low insulin or low effects of insulin. So here you have the cells that are starving of food and nutrition and in energy and glucose, yet you have all this sugar piling up in the blood. So you have, it's going to send signals back around to jack up the insulin. So people with insulin resistance have 5 to 7 times more insulin than normal people. And so many people have insulin resistance, they don't even know they have it. It takes 10 years to develop. It causes a stubborn belly fat. It creates problems with a fatty liver. And then having a fatty liver actually causes insulin resistance. So it's one big ugly cycle. So some of the symptoms are tired after you eat lunch or a dinner, not satisfied after you eat, craving for sweets is a big one. Basically, high blood pressure, fluid retention, these are all symptoms of insulin resistance. Okay? Does that help? That was amazing. That was amazing. That was a very good explanation of insulin resistance. Thank you. There are gurus out there that are just pushing this avoidance of saturated fats. I'm going to show you one right here, Joslin Diabetes Center. Now, if you look at one section of their website, they have the 5 myths, okay? And this is just totally bogus information. I'm going to have my buddy just explain and share these myths with you. So would you just go ahead and show them these myths? Sure, no problem. So we have the 5 common myths for people with diabetes debunked, okay? This is actually ridiculous. People with diabetes have to eat different foods from the rest of the family, right? People with diabetes can eat the same foods as the rest of the family. That's what they're recommending. That is crazy. What if they're eating sugar? You're gonna eat the same thing? Bad advice. Here's another myth. People with diabetes should never give in to food cravings. Okay, they're calling that a myth, all right? It says right here, if a craving does occur, let yourself have a small taste of whatever it is you want. In doing so, you'll enjoy the flavor and avoid overeating later on. Bad advice. This is as bad as eating everything in moderation, because as soon as you start eating something, you are going to want it more and craving it, because it's going to spike the sugar and drop it. The point is that the definition of fat is something to protect you against the starvation of sugar. This doesn't starve your sugar. It gives you a little bit through the day, just enough to block any chance of losing weight. To be able to lose weight, you have to literally drop sugars way, 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 way down there, especially if it's slow metabolism, because just the nature, you're not gonna make the switch to fat burning if you don't do that. So bad advice. Number 3, people with diabetes shouldn't eat too many starchy foods, even if they contain fiber, because starch raises your blood glucose and makes you gain weight. They're calling that a myth. Starchy foods such as bread, pasta, rice, cereal provide carbohydrate, the body's energy source. That's not true. The body can run on ketones, which is a different fuel source from fat. Fruit, milk, yogurt, and desserts contain carbohydrate as well. Everyone needs some carbohydrates in their diet. No, they don't. Even people with diabetes. diabetics have too much sugar in their blood, okay? So they don't need to add more sugar in their diet to stimulate the insulin. weight gain occurs when you take in more calories than you burn off. This is one of the oldest, crappiest lies. They keep pushing this. This is not true. It's been proven to be an utter failure. Number four, people with diabetes do not have to worry about eating fats because it doesn't have much effect on the blood glucose. They're calling that a myth. Fat found in margarine, oil, salad dressings have a little intermediate effect on blood glucose levels. However, eating a fatty meal can slow down digestion and make it harder for your insulin to work, causing a possible high glucose levels hours after your meal. Again, that's not the reason. The reason is fats are neutral. Fats are neutral, and he's going to show you that in the next part. So you don't have to worry about eating fat. Fat doesn't increase glucose. Sugar does. If you combine them, that's really deadly. Okay, so yeah, that's all I'm saying. Now I'm going to zipit.com over to you. Well, thank you. Appreciate that. There are gurus out there that will tell you that sugar doesn't cause insulin resistance or even diabetes. So check out this clip right here.
It's a myth that sugar causes diabetes. Many people think that the consumption of high carbohydrate foods or foods high in sugar are the cause of diabetes. It's easy to think that high blood sugar is caused by sugar.
This is so not true. Sugar does cause diabetes. Check out this clip.
What causes insulin resistance? It's intramyocellular lipid. It's fat that's inside the muscle fibers that interferes with insulin signaling such that your body has to keep pumping insulin to try to force it into your muscles, which use up about 85% of your blood sugars. Your blood sugars rise because they can't enter into the cells. And not just any fat, but particularly saturated fat is toxic. It's called lipotoxicity.
Interesting, eh? We'll check out one more clip.
All fats don't affect muscles the same. The type of fat, saturated versus unsaturated, is critical. Saturated fats like palmitate, found mostly in meat, dairy, eggs, cause insulin resistance. But oleate, found mostly in nuts, olives, avocados, may actually improve insulin sensitivity.
You see, this is why it's so frustrating, because you're getting conflicting information. One doctor says eat fat, and the other doctor says avoid fat. It's massive confusion. This is why I drink on the weekends. No, I don't drink on the weekends. It's going to increase my sugar, basically. So here's the point. The point is you need to be able to understand what the actual research really says. And for that, I'm going to bring on my buddy over here that's going to go over the research just so you can see yourself what the truth is. Over to you. I'll help you out. Okay. So we got here's some research articles that show the relationship of a low-carbohydrate diet compared to a low-fat diet. This is from the New England Journal of Medicine. This is what it says right here. It says, severely obese subjects with a high prevalence of diabetes or the metabolic syndrome lost more weight during 6 months on a carbohydrate-restricted diet than on a calorie or fat-restricted diet, okay? With relative improvement in insulin sensitivity. So in this study, they're showing that having some fat and low carbs is a good thing for your blood sugars, okay? That's what it's saying. But of course, people ignore that. Okay, here's another one. Beyond weight loss, a review of the therapeutic uses of a very low carbohydrate ketogenic diet. See, ketogenic is more of a diet where you're involving adding a lot more fat to the diet, but you have to keep the sugars really low. It says right here, very low carbohydrate diets or ketogenic diets have been used since the 1920s. Recent work over the last decade has provided evidence of the therapeutic potential of ketogenic diets in many conditions, such as diabetes, and even other ones too, polycystic ovarian syndrome, acne, neurological disease, cancer, respiratory, cardiovascular. I mean, come on, these are research articles that show that saturated fats are not that bad, okay, that are actually therapeutic in nature. Here's one, the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, long-term effects of a very low carbohydrate loss diet compared with an isocalorie low fat diet. Yeah, and here's another one, the effects of a low carbohydrate versus conventional weight loss diet in severe obese adults, a 1-year follow-up of a randomized trial. It's basically showing us that fat diets are not the culprit, okay? So this is research that just proves that. And what we want to do is we don't want to be afraid of fat, okay? So over to you, my friend.
Wow, that's amazing.
Do you realize there were really only 7 studies that were done on this topic? And out of the 7, only one study showed a weak relationship. It was called almost statistically significant. What does that mean? Almost is not always. Almost is sort of, but not really. So all 6 studies showed that there was no influence or no effect on your blood sugars by eating saturated fats. But they ignored those, okay? So really, these theories are based on one very weak study that they're using as the reason to get the population off of the fats, and this makes sugar okay to eat. So you keep eating the sugar, you keep eating the sugar, and you never get better, but you still take your medication. There's something else called the insulin index. There's certain research that was done to look at the relationship between non-carbohydrate things that stimulate insulin. And the thing that I want to bring up on the insulin index is that fats are low on the list, which means they're almost neutral. They don't affect insulin unless you add sugar. But if you're just having a pure fat, they buffer insulin. Because if you were to take a low-fat, high-concentrated whey protein mix, that is a high insulin spike, by the way, and you took an egg which has yolk and egg white, the yolk buffers the egg white. It makes it smaller in the reaction to insulin. So fats, this whole time, have been totally okay to consume. In fact, necessary if you have a pre-diabetic state. Why? Because it allows you to go longer without eating. So if you're not eating, you drop insulin down. And you can actually really help people lose weight, help them with their blood sugars, so they're not eating 6 times a day, help them with the correct action. So really, here's the thing. The culprit has never been fat. It's never been the culprit. I'm talking about healthy fats and saturated fats I consider healthy if they're grass-fed and they're not and they're organic. So I want to just bring that point out to really teach you that, because that is the most important thing to emphasize, is that avoid the carbohydrates, not the fats. Okay? I'll see you in the next video.